It's a pleasure to be back here at Rollins College. Actually, as I was preparing for the presentation, I realized that the first time I was here, I sort of gave an early rendition of this talk that I'm going to give today. It's still very much a work in progress for my paper, but the framework that I'm laying out very much builds onto what I presented a couple of years ago here. So there's a lot of reminiscing as I went through the preparation. My topic is on weaponizing globalization, Chinese high tech in the crosshairs of geopolitics. And as I walk through the talk, I think you will see there's a lot of sort of synergy with what Dr. Larson has presented, because the impetus for this presentation was very much based on the current U.S.-China relationship and the competition, the rivalry, who is going to remain or become the dominant player in the international system. And even though I just mentioned before to a colleague here that I was not going to bring up Graham Allison, I think this is actually a nice way to introduce it nonetheless. Graham Allison's book about Destined for War, if you look at one of his early chapters, actually the very first chapter where he outlines why, or what the premise of his book is, it's sort of a diachronic study of history has shown that when you have an existing power and a rising power, in 12 out of 16 situations, you have actually outright conflict. Now, I'm not going to discuss whether or not that is going to be the case, but I will look at it through the case or through the context of high-tech industries and the competition that is unfolding, specifically with regard to 5G. I will mention artificial intelligence a little bit as well, and how and why Huawei finds itself in the crosshairs of geopolitics there. And I might digress from the Chinese case here for a minute and give you a quote from the Russian president, who in 2017, speaking in front of an audience of Russian students and journalists, had this to say about artificial intelligence. "Artificial intelligence is the future. Whoever becomes the leader in this sphere will become the ruler of the world." So the stage is set for a competition in terms of who is going to be on the frontier of high-tech research and development and the next sort of emerging technologies. On a little bit more of an ominous note, we had 3 days after President Putin made that statement, the founder of SpaceX and Tesla, Elon Musk, sending out a tweet. It was a lot more alarming when he said, "Competition for AI superiority at national level most likely cause a World War III, IMO, in my opinion." That's a lot more alarming. So when I came across these, I thought, well, this would be a nice way to actually look at the challenges as all, and also the opportunities that Huawei is presently facing, not just necessarily in the U.S. market, but as it expands globally. And it brings me back to sort of the fusion between political scientists, because I'm a political scientist by training. I've just more recently gone into international business. And one of the things that I always had a little bit of an issue with when it comes to IB theories, they were always maybe a little bit sort of too narrowly focused, and there's always one aspect that was missing in the broader theoretical and conceptual discussion, and that is sort of the geopolitical or the geostrategic context that needs to be brought in, and that is informing the model or the framework, I should say, for my presentation and for my paper, which is still very much a work in progress. So when you look at Huawei and why Huawei is in the crosshairs of geopolitics, well, obviously you will look at the globalization context, what Huawei has been doing for the last couple of years, where it has expanded to, where it has gotten market share, and how in various business segments, whether that's the carrier segment, the enterprise segment, the consumer segment. But you can't discuss this without also having a good grounding in the national innovation context. And this is where you begin to see a very stark differentiation between what is going on in China as opposed to the US, and it might actually help us to understand the emerging rivalry. When we talk about national innovation, I will make the case that in terms of an actual full-blown strategy, we don't have it. The US doesn't have it. We talk about it, we have meetings about it. There's a White House summit in 2018 on artificial intelligence. There was a hearing in front of the U.S. Senate Commerce Committee on artificial intelligence, but the full-blown articulation of a coherent strategy seems to still be missing. This is where China has already sort of leapfrogged ahead, as have other countries, and I will mention two of those national innovation pushes. Once we have that, we of course will look at the competition context. Where does Huawei, where does China's push for innovation and technological development create competition? Is it real competition? Is it confrontation? Is it co-opetition at the international level? Which brings me to the fourth point, which is this geostrategic context, because you will see that Huawei is not just suffering like a lot of foreign businesses when they internationalize from the liability of foreigners. It may also not just be a question of timing, when do you go into which markets, when do you expand your market share, but it's really about the geostrategic reality, because we are literally in a situation right now where the United States has been and will continue to be, as uncomfortable as it may sound, in relative decline. Maybe not necessarily militarily, but certainly economically. Some of it is due to our own making. We have made pronouncements about deglobalizing, essentially. We have become more protectionist. If you wanted to sort of see a very nice juxtaposition of those ideas, in 2017, in November at the APEC meeting in Vietnam, President Xi Jinping and President Donald Trump both gave sort of keynote speeches. President Trump was the first one, and his message was in very stark contrast to what President Xi had said. One was more inward-looking, lambasting the ill effects, the discontents of globalization, and Xi Jinping came out and basically said, yes, there are problems, but we will have to work at fixing the global economy. We're essentially sitting in the same boat, so it's for mutual benefit. It's the same idea that the Chinese have been pushing as they go out in terms of the Belt and Road Initiative, which one of our colleagues will also talk about, the win-win situation. But from the U.S. perspective, and this is what I want to focus on a little bit more, is where does the U.S. fit in? Are we prepared to share the stage with China? Do we look at the challenge coming from China, from Huawei, as a threat, or maybe also as an opportunity? We should probably look at it more as an opportunity to become more innovative, to reinvigorate national innovation in a sense that we haven't done yet. Let me give you some very brief, this I'm going to fly from, not going to dwell on it too much, but most of you are probably familiar in some way, shape, or form with the overall performance of Huawei. This is just a quick snapshot from about the last 12 years in terms of how much the company has grown through its overall global operations. Revenue is at an all-time high as of 2018. Net income keeps growing as well. It dipped a little bit in 2011, 2012, but it's certainly on the upward trajectory. And if you look at the global positioning, Huawei right now is operating in about 170 countries. I could have probably given you a longer snapshot here, but just to not overload the slide, I kept it to the last sort of 6 years, 2013 to 2018. And what you will see is that obviously the China market is the major market right now. It has grown tremendously, but that's probably also, at least in part, the result of the policies that the Trump administration had put in place, how we have reacted to the Huawei challenge, its ambition to launch the 5G, which the U.S. is behind. Huawei is one of two or three companies in the world that really have all the equipment to build a full-blown 5G network. No American company can do that at the moment. So there's a little bit more of a defensive reaction to that. And as that happened, we have heard stories about companies even in China sort of trying to incentivize their employees to buy Huawei phones as opposed to Apple phones. So maybe the waving of the techno-nationalism flag has also contributed to the uptake in the China market. But more importantly, what you will see is that in the Europe, Middle East, and Africa markets, they have gradually been growing. Interestingly enough, most of the technological breakthroughs, even in their smartphones, that they are being tested in overseas markets, always in Europe. There has been a little bit more of a friendly reaction to Huawei than certainly in the United States. And you can see that the Americas have consistently sort of more or less stayed stagnant in terms of the market share that Huawei has. Now, I mentioned the national innovation context before. And I said that the United States doesn't have a full-blown national innovation strategy, at least not on the likes of what the Chinese have right now. That doesn't mean to say that we don't have the ingredients for a broader an ecosystem, but we haven't actually found the real connection. You might be very good in research and development, but in terms of cultivating the talent, we have a lack of qualified individuals that go into that field. We may actually educate some of our future competition, and with our domestic politics, we actually make it much more difficult for these people also to stick around to the extent that we even bring them in the first place these days. So we send them back home and they will create their own future competition for the United States. I mentioned the committee hearing. There was one in February 2018 on the US Senate. Hearings are nice, but at what point do we make the transition from having had the hearing, having had a White House summit, to actually crafting a full-blown national innovation strategy. In the same way that some economists have actually come around after the global financial crisis to also talking about the need for a national industrial strategy, or at least in the automotive sector, for example. We don't have that either because we leave it up to market forces, and generally that's not where you have an innovation strategy necessarily coming about. So there's a role for government in terms of jumpstarting or creating the incentives and the background for full-blown sustainable competition in emerging technologies. The Chinese have done so. I mentioned, and there are probably more. I highlighted two initiatives, the Made in China 2025 initiative. An initiative launched in 2015 by which the Chinese government is trying to transform the Chinese economy not just into the basic advanced manufacturing powers, but the high-tech manufacturing superpower. They identified 10 priority areas. So the government, yes, has identified specific areas. And that's actually very synonymous with what you have seen in Asia before with the developmental state strategies that Japan had done, that that Korea had done, that Taiwan had embraced, which is not something that we necessarily do to the same extent. When it comes to artificial intelligence, there's also a development plan where China has four specific goals. And as a matter of fact, the CSIS think tank in DC just came out yesterday with another report on artificial intelligence where the US stacks up as well, and whether or not China's advances might constitute a threat or a challenge in the future. The four strategic goals that China is pursuing: it wants to become a center of fundamental AI research and theory development, lead applied research and development of cutting-edge AI products and services, basically build a world-leading AI industry domestically, which then also can dominate the global markets. So there's definitely the ingredients for potential collision course or competition with the U.S. in terms of innovation and high-tech industries going forward. Competition obviously requires a lot of R&D. If I switch here to Huawei as an example for a moment, Huawei has invested a slightly higher percentage of its revenues into R&D than most of its peer competitors. On average, it has been about 14 to 15% of revenues are consistently pushed into R&D. You look at the number of business segments that it is playing in, it's all the way from carrier businesses, as I mentioned before, to enterprise businesses, consumer businesses, and other sectors. The consumer business, yes, has taken off a lot more in recent years. That's probably if you look at the smartphone segment, Huawei has made inroads there. The third chart here might be a little difficult to see. Huawei has grabbed the number two spot in terms of global smartphone shipments. Apple has consistently been on the decline. Samsung is declining a little bit as well. And it was recently even mentioned that had it not been for the latest trade tensions with the U.S. and the tariffs that were imposed on China, Huawei might have been on track to even overtake Samsung to be the leading producer of smartphones in the world. Now, the U.S. is definitely looking at what are the costs of losing the race for 5G leadership, and that might have brought Huawei squarely into the crosshairs, because Huawei is seen as constituting a very significant challenge, a technological challenge to the United States. And if you look at actually, did the United States lead in 2 and 3G technologies? No, it did not. Europe got the lead there. The US actually got the lead in 4G technology. And the costs, again, of not being the leader are significant. There are economic benefits, there are job employment benefits. Right now, the 4G leadership role has contributed to about 4.7 million jobs in the United States that are directly tied to this. And there's a significant economic benefit as well, beyond just employment. And if you look where China stacks up today, it already has a little bit of an edge in terms of laying the infrastructure for 5G. In 2017, the data suggested that China was adding approximately 460 site cells per day that will be used for 5G. At the present time, the United States has about less than 5 cell sites per 10,000 people. China has about 14. So they're already ahead in that sense. And again, it comes back to the lack of a concerted national innovation strategy that we have. If we leave it up too much to the market forces, you might say then that is not necessarily going to work. You don't just use the market concentration argument that you see in economics today. If there's market concentration, you have no incentive on the supply side to put more money in research and development, but not when you are looking at the global stage and you have foreign competition. If you want to be on the leading edge, you have to invest significant amounts and you have to have a strategy that keeps you on that track. Now, Huawei is caught between a rock and a hard place in the sense that the timing at which it is becoming or trying to become a leader really brings it face to face in competition with the US, because we are at a stage of global rivalry. The United States, as I said, is in relative decline. China is rising up. And Huawei might just be the one target that the US zooms in on right now. So it's not just a simple liability of foreignness, not understanding the foreign markets and so on, but now it's a liability of foreignness compounded by the fact that, well, it's a Chinese company, and the perception that is still very prevalent in many corners is that, well, every Chinese company by default is a state-owned company, which is not true. Huawei is not a state-owned company for that matter. But the recent decision in China to also embed the sort of government officials into most of the major companies, including Alibaba, was an article recently, that might not necessarily make it any easier for Chinese companies to sort of be seen as decoupled from the government. And as a result of this, as we saw that competitive challenge coming down to it, rather than actually using the advances of Huawei as sort of the, a Sputnik moment, or you look at supercomputers. China had, up until for the last couple of years, last 2 years, China had the fastest supercomputer in the world, the Sunmei Taihu Light computer. The United States hadn't had that leadership role since November 2012. It just got it back in June 2018. So we might be back on top there, but we would even want to look at that as sort of the Taihu Light moment to basically call for a reinvigorated national innovation strategy, focusing on education, because that's one of our Achilles heels as well when it comes to science and technology, to give us the tools to marshal all the resources which we have and combine them in a concerted strategy. That has not happened yet. So it's much easier to react to a competitive challenge and impose tariffs. And Donald Trump had done this in early April 2018, 25% tariffs on 1,300 Chinese products was about $50 billion and was squarely directed against companies that also are focusing on artificial intelligence and other high-tech products. And it's a result because we are losing that innovation capacity. There's a very interesting book that actually got me interested in this topic, called Innovation Economics and the Global Race for Innovation Advantage, and where two authors, two economists in 2012 made the case that the United States is losing that race. We have also come up with a new Foreign Investment Risk Review Modernization Act, which is scrutinizing foreign investments in the United States. But it's scrutinizing investments that in the past had not been under the purview of the Committee on Foreign Investment in the United States. So this is, again, sort of a defensive reaction when what we need is more, you know, open-minded thinking. We might also react to Huawei and other companies because China has what a historian at Princeton University, his name escapes me now, he recently called, or he described what he termed China's road or new globalization push in the magazine Global Finance. And the new globalization push is done on the back of another initiative, the Belt and Road Initiative. We don't have that grand strategy, that strategic framework to look at the world and push for that co-opetition. We see more competition as confrontation rather as an opportunity to also cooperate. So what we're looking at is really a paradigm shift that we're in right now. We might be talking about the trade war and the trade tensions, but really it's a tech war. And the only way to get around this is to actually look inwards and find the resources and come up with the innovation strategies that we need to compete with China. And I'm told I'm out of time, and it's right on time. So thank you very much.